Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the National Constitution Center. It's such a pleasure to see you here. I am Jeffrey Rosen. I am the president of this wonderful institution. The National Constitution Center is the only institution in America chartered by Congress to disseminate information about the US Constitution on a nonpartisan basis. And as part of this wonderful mandate, we have three goals. We're the Museum of We the People, and in October we'll be displaying a rare copy of the Bill of Rights. We are a center for civic education, and we are America's town hall, the one place that summons all sides of the constitutional debates that rivet American society and allow citizens to make up their own mind. And in the past weeks, in the coming months, we've had such a remarkable and exciting variety of town hall programs. Just last week, we had a debate between Alan Dershowitz and Noah Feldman and others about whether the president has the constitutional power to target and kill American citizens abroad. And the vote initially was no, but after a rousing speech by Alan Dershowitz, the audience changed its mind to yes. Tomorrow, Jeff Toobin from The New Yorker is going to come for a great discussion of whether our Constitution is broken. And in the spring, we're handing out our latest spring mailer. I'm just so excited about this dizzying array of programs, from Justice John Paul Stevens making one of his few appearances, to Lynn Cheney on James Madison, to several books about the 50th anniversary of the Civil Rights Act, to the history of the Second Amendment. Here at the Constitution Center, it is constitutional heaven every day of the week, and we are so proud to share it with you. Finally, I'll just say, please do look at our new and redesigned website, constitutioncenter.org. All of these great new programs, as well as our weekly podcasts, can be found on our homepage, and we hope you'll enjoy them as much as we've enjoyed presenting them. My friends, ladies and gentlemen, out of all the topics that I'm privileged to discuss here at the great National Constitution Center, there is none that I'm more excited about than privacy, and there is no author that I've been more looking forward to meeting in person and talking with than Julia Angwin. We are fellow soldiers in the privacy trenches for many years as journalists. We've both written about privacy, and there is no reporter in America from whom I've learned more than Julia. Your path-breaking reports in the Wall Street Journal and elsewhere about the tangible harms of online tracking, and especially the details about how much precisely is being collected and what is being done with it, are unparalleled. You were a finalist for the Pulitzer Prize in 2012 because of your incredible Wall Street Journal series on this subject, which revealed for the first time something that many of us hadn't known, which is that, among other harms, people are actually charged different prices online based on the profiles that faceless algorithms create about us without our knowledge or consent. Let me just finally, to introduce Julia properly, note some of her other many great achievements. She is currently a journalist at the wonderful and independent news organization Pro Publica. She was a reporter at the Wall Street Journal from 2000 to 2013 and was a finalist for the Pulitzer Prize in 2011. She was on a team of reporters that won the Pulitzer in 2003 in explanatory reporting for coverage of corporate corruption. She's also the author of Stealing MySpace, The Battle to Control the Most Popular Website in America. We are so thrilled, I am so thrilled, to have Julia here to discuss her latest book, Dragnet Nation, A Quest for Privacy, Security, and Freedom in a World of Relentless Surveillance. Welcome, Julia Angwin.
Thank you.
We have so much to discuss. I'm going to start with the obvious opening question. What surprised you most about how much companies and the government know about you?
Well, thanks for having me here. I'm a huge fan of your work as well, and a great introduction, thank you. In my book, Dragnet Nation, I decided to take the privacy investigations I'd done at the Wall Street Journal a step further by investigating myself, right? What is known about me, and what can I protect? And so I sought my data from as many places as I could find, which actually was very few places. So for instance, I identified 200 data brokers out there, but only a dozen would let me see my files, because there's no law requiring them to. But interestingly, even in that small set of files, it was shocking how wrong some of them were and how right some of them were. So some companies were completely wrong about me. One company said I had never completed college, I was a single mother, and I had a very poverty level income. And that none of those things happened to be true. other files were incredibly detailed and had every address I had ever lived at, going back to the number on my dorm room in college, which I had actually forgotten. and every member of my family perfectly associated to me, and all sorts of purchases that I had made, including ones I had made fairly recently. So on the whole, they knew a lot about me. And occasionally, they knew all sorts of wrong things about me, and I couldn't decide which one actually outraged me more.
Were you surprised by how much Google knew? It was the depth and precision of your searches that surprised me and actually freaked me out a little bit.
Yes, so my Google search history was incredibly shocking to me. So since I joined Gmail in 2006, they had been storing all my searches, and that's a long time. And when I started to look at my searches, I realized how revealing they were. They were far more revealing than my addresses, because it was a map of every single day. I would wake up in the morning and I would Google the weather, and then I would Google, you know, something about something with my kid's school, was it open? Then I would look at what article I was researching that topic. Then I would start weirdly shopping for online kids' clothing. And you could just see my mind making its little leaps. And the idea that there was a record of the mental madness that goes on really disturbed me. And I quit using Google search after that.
We'll talk about the alternatives and how you cope with them. But there was more that struck me. You got your TSA records and found that the description of why you were going abroad for a reporting trip was actually reported to private companies and then turned over to the government.
Yeah, this was shocking. So I went to the Customs and Border Patrol and I said, give me the record of my border crossings. So that's one of the few sets of files that you can obtain from the government fairly easily, if easily means waiting 3 months and writing letters. And right, with that, that's a relative standard,
yes, exactly.
Right? So it was incredibly comprehensive. And what I learned from it was that the Wall Street Journal, where I was working, used a travel agency, which used a system that basically automatically sent some of the internal communications that I had with my boss. I had to fill out a little online form about why was I traveling, etc., and my boss would approve it, and that's how my travel would get approved. And just by the virtue of sort of like no one paying any attention, all those communications were swept into the government files. And so when I brought this to the Wall Street Journal, they understandably flipped out, because you know, advanced knowledge of where reporters are going about what story is something probably they don't want the government to have. So they actually stopped working with that travel agency for a period of time until they got it fixed. But it took quite a bit of time. And this is one of the many problems of this data age that we live in right now, is people don't even know where the data is going. If I had asked the Wall Street Journal, where is the data, they would have said, oh, it's secure, it's right here, and they didn't know.
The amount of inaccuracies, the glitches, it seemed very hard to get a sense of control and a handle on just how much was out there.
Yeah, it was very difficult to get a handle on it, and I'm sure I don't have a handle on it. I've probably seen some very thin layer at the top of what's really known about me, because, as I said before, most companies don't have to share it, or even if they do share it, for instance, Facebook let me download an archive of what they had on me. But we know, actually, from a European who obtained a fuller set of his data from Facebook under stricter European privacy laws, that what I saw was less than what they have, because his file, it had everyone who he had deleted as friends, it had posts that he had deleted, so it actually kind of kept this ghostly records of things that he thought were gone, whereas the one I saw was a more sanitized version.
Okay, well, we're gonna discuss in a little bit the steps you took to protect your privacy, but before we do that, I wanna talk through with you a question that both of us get all the time. Whenever you speak about privacy, people say, what's the harm? Nothing to hide, nothing to fear. I'm not doing anything wrong. Why should I care if Google knows my search results? And the great virtue of, one of the many great virtues of this book, is that you enumerate those harms with great specificity, and you give us specific examples of people who were harmed in different ways. Let's start with government surveillance.
Okay.
And you talk a lot about Edward Snowden and the PRISM program and the fact that the government is collecting the metadata, that is the telephone numbers that we dial and so forth, and the duration of the calls, as well as intercepting the content of some conversations. I'm not a terrorist. Why should I care? What's not?
Right. So this is the most common question.
usually I get it. I'm sorry. But it was a pleasure for me to be able to ask you that question.
Right.
Why are you so upset about privacy? Aren't you? You must be a terrorist yourself, aren't
that's
you?
Right. That's right. Yeah, exactly.
So what's the harm?
It's interesting, first of all, that we even have this harm conversation, because it's worth noting that in Europe, there's no need to justify this. Privacy is considered a human right, and it's just a given. You don't have to have this conversation. Putting that aside, though, this is the U.S. We want to debate this, so let's debate it. The thing that I think is the biggest harm from government surveillance, actually, is that it leads us to be less free with our speech. So I write about this guy in my book who was surveilled by the FBI. He and his friend, they're both teenage young men in Santa Clara, and his friend had written a kind of sassy post on a social network called Reddit, and he had basically said, I don't know why the TSA is so crazy at airports. You know, I could just go to a mall and bomb it, no problem, right? Which is actually true, but, you know, maybe unwise to say, but he said it. So a couple weeks later, this guy and his friend were at the car shop getting an oil change, and the friend, Yasser, saw that there was something under his car. It was a tracking device. And the FBI had put this on his car to surveil him, and he later found out that it was because of his friend's comment. So this is already kind of a disturbing story, but what I found really disturbing was what happened afterwards. So after they found out they were being surveilled by the FBI, their friendship fell apart. The author didn't want to be friends with a guy who might put him in danger, right? He became incredibly circumspect in his actions, and he doesn't feel free to talk about anything subversive, and he is Muslim, American, and he now uses a different name, Aladdin, because he feels like it's less Muslim. And he's still detained every time he comes across international borders. And he doesn't feel like he has the same sort of free speech rights that I feel like is a central part of our country.
You argue so powerfully in that chapter that it's not just privacy, but free speech that's at stake, that at the core of what the framers were concerned about was enough practical obscurity to be able to engage in political dissent. And yet, as you say, the Supreme Court has not been sympathetic to claims that mass surveillance violates free speech.
No, the Supreme Court has not. And there are a number of reasons why they've taken that path. But largely, it's been over this issue of standing, which is that you can't prove you're surveilled, and so that you can't show any harm. You know, we have an interesting case coming up, which is now after Snowden, people can prove that they were surveilled. And so it'll be interesting to see whether the Supreme Court revisits that. But one thing that I talked about in that chapter, I called it freedom of association, because actually, even more than speech, I was concerned about association, because Yasser was afraid to associate with his friend anymore. And what big data is really a way to build associations, right? People who collect big data say the thing that they love about it is you suddenly realize that people who buy felt pads to put under their furniture are better credit risks, and you would never have seen that in any other data because it was too small, as they say, and so it builds associations. But we do have a history of protecting freedom of association, right? The NAACP versus Alabama case, where Alabama wanted the list of members of the NAACP, and the Supreme Court upheld the right to keep that list private. Now, the thing is, those lists are no longer private because you don't have to join the young Muslim men of Santa Clara anymore. Yasser was automatically entered into that by the digital trail that he left behind.
In addition to those great First Amendment concerns, you also identify Fourth Amendment concerns. And you actually went to the former East Germany and found out what the Stasi knew about its citizens. How much more or less did the Stasi know than Google knows about you?
Right. Well, so the Stasi, if they really wanted you, there were a couple people on whom they had dozens of binders. They measured their surveillance in binders, right? So some people had like 30 binders, 50 binders. But I looked at average files, which were 20 to 50 pages long, handwritten. I got them translated by Stasi experts. And they were not as robust as what I was a typical Facebook profile, even. Because nowadays, the Facebook timeline dates back several years, and you can see quite a bit about someone. Now, that's not to say that they didn't know how to be repressive. They were far more repressive a government, and you know, I always want to be cautious with this, which is that we are better at surveillance, but not as good at repression, and I think that we want to make sure we keep it that way.
It's a good balance, believe me. Does it work? You tell the story of Zazi, who I guess is one of the people who the government has offered as an example of someone who was caught through this prism surveillance. And yet it's not clear that the surveillance itself was the cause of it and that he might not have been caught without it.
Yeah, the Zazi case is the one that the government uses most often to defend the NSA's bulk surveillance programs ever since the Snowden revelations. And Zazi was a guy who wanted to blow up the subways in New York City. And they did identify him because he had written an email to somebody in overseas who was a known terrorist. And they did catch that through the prison program. Now, the thing is, though, you don't need a bulk surveillance program to monitor communications to known terrorists. We actually have a process for that. It's called get a secret warrant to monitor the communications of terrorists. And so that was their tip. But basically, they caught him by literally chasing him across the country in cars. He was driving from Denver to New York, and they had like a team of agents trailing him. It was incredibly old school.
Now, the GPS device that Yasser was followed by was a form of search that the Supreme Court later struck down in the Jones case and said that you're not allowed to put a GPS device on the bottom of a car and track people's movements 24/7 for a month. What about the future of Fourth Amendment issues? You talk about fascinating cell phone tracking cases. You say it's currently open whether or not the government is allowed, now that they can no longer put a GPS device on the bottom of my car, they can just subpoena the geolocational information stored by AT&T or Verizon or whatever it is.
Right.
And some folks in Congress are saying you need a warrant for that. The government is pushing back.
Right.
What will the courts do? What should
so we
they
have
do?
The problem we have with the Fourth Amendment and these devices.
Yes, I'm using this for timing now, not to track you anymore.
Right, but they are the best tracking device ever devised, right? We keep them next to our beds. I mean, like, any spy would love their target to carry such a thing.
Yeah.
So the problem is the Fourth Amendment, the way the court has interpreted it has been very much about the boundaries of your actual home. So the Fourth Amendment protects the papers and effects in your home, and so the interpretation has been that if you give your information to somebody outside the home, a third party, such as the phone company or a bank, you have a lesser expectation of privacy in those records. And so that allows the government to get your cell phone records with less of a legal standard. And that is known as the third party doctrine. In the Jones case that you referenced, Justice Sotomayor suggested that it might be time to reconsider that in a world where we basically store all of our papers in third-party servers. But that hasn't yet been opened up by the court.
This is a law professor's question. I'm only asking because I don't know the answer and I'm interested in it. What is the best alternative to the third-party doctrine? In other words, so Justice Sotomayor says, we have a problem. In a world where the Supreme Court said, if I take data and store it in a database held by a third party, I have no expectation of privacy in it. That means none of us have any privacy. But she didn't say what the court should do as an alternative.
Well, I mean, I don't know that I know the answer, but I think it's worth pointing out that all of the tech companies, from AT&T to Google to Facebook, are lobbying to get that particular part of the law changed. They want the search warrant to be the standard for cell phone location records, email, really sensitive data that currently, because of the third party doctrine, is easier for the government to get.
So as you say, Congress could pass a bill saying you need a warrant to get access to this information.
Yes.
And that would help things.
Yes, it would.
I'm just gonna throw it out there, so maybe you can, if you like it, you can push it as well. But I love your First Amendment argument so much. And whenever I have a hard privacy question, I ask, WWBD, what would Brandeis do? Because he's my privacy hero. And I think he would have insisted that the framers believed that a degree of practical obscurity and anonymity was necessary for full democratic participation, and forms of ubiquitous tracking that defeat that expectation are unreasonable searches of our persons and electronic effects. What do you think of that?
I think that certainly Brandeis would agree with that. I think what's interesting, I heard an argument recently that I thought was interesting, which was maybe the Second Amendment should protect us, the right to bear counter-surveillance, which I thought was actually a great idea, right? Because I have kind of armed myself with counter-surveillance, right? And that puts me on a suspicious list, actually. But it may well be that there's a level of anonymity needed for political discourse that would be allowed by this, right? By the fact that I have my phone in a bag that prevents all signals from getting through.
So tell about this incredible Faraday bag. This is the hottest privacy fashion accessory for the spring. all fashionable privacy advocates will carry them. What is this?
So what this is basically a bag that's lined with some thin metal, and the metal prevents any signals from getting in and out. So when my phone is in the bag, then it's not communicating with the cell towers or with any Wi-Fi networks. It's really just off the grid. And it saves me from having to constantly think, okay, have I got my location setting on or whatever? And so I just throw it in the bag, and then I'm not trackable. And it's worth pointing out that, you know, you could turn your phone off to do this, but the head of the CIA chief technical officer went public a year ago saying, you know, we can track you even when your phone is off, which basically probably means remotely activating the microphone or some other part of it. And so true privacy paranoids put their phones in bags. And actually, you know, this is something that protesters do, because the cops want to know who's at the protest. And so it's actually commonly used by Occupy and other people.
This is the time for me to use the Woody Allen line: just because you're paranoid doesn't mean they're not out to get you. Now, the Faraday bag is a far more stylish alternative to your original approach, which was wrapping your phone in tinfoil.
Yes,
How did you feel when you wrapped your phone in tinfoil?
Well, so I thought I was going to get a Faraday bag, but I was talking to this guy who was an ex-CIA guy, and he was like, oh, honey, you don't need a Faraday bag. You just wrap your phone in tinfoil. I was like, okay, I'll try it. So I spent a day wrapping my phone in tinfoil, and it was horrible. Really embarrassing. You know, I got to my office and I was sort of peeling it open, trying not to tear it, you know, to check something and then put it back in. And by the end of the day, it looked like that very crinkly sandwich smushed look. And my colleague said to me, he said, Julia, I actually know someone who can get you a Faraday bag, so you have to stop doing this because you look crazy.
Where do you get them, by the way?
So you can get them on Amazon.
Okay.
This one I got from a guy who's like an art. He does counter-surveillance art in New York, and it's called the Off Pocket.
We could start up a little operation at the Constitution Center and sell them together. You know, it would be a great little franchise.
The Constitution plus Off Pocket. I think that's
absolutely
a great idea.
But now, Faraday bags, obviously some of our audience, well, actually, I'm kind of curious. Based on our conversation so far, who in the audience would buy a Faraday bag?
All right. Wow. We should start this business.
And who thinks that this is just too much and would not buy the Faraday bag?
Okay.
So this is actually almost two-thirds. So it's a hearty and already committed audience here at the Constitution Center today. But I think we have a little more work to do to persuade the non-Faraday bag people about what the harms are. So again, the great virtue of this book, there are stories, there are practical tips about how to protect your privacy, but you really give us the harms. So we've talked about the harms of government surveillance. Let us talk about the harms of private sector surveillance and being tracked by online companies. And I mentioned the great contribution of your Wall Street Journal articles was to reveal that people may be charged different prices online based on who the companies think they are. Tell us about that example of differential pricing.
Right. So what's happening now when you are online is your computer transmits far more information about you than you would think, right? You imagine yourself being very anonymous. But when you arrive at a website, and a retailer website, or somebody's trying to sell you something, they already have quite a bit of information about you. And they can dynamically change the page to tailor it exactly to you. This is actually marketed to you as personalization and as a benefit. And sometimes it is. When Amazon tells you what books you might want, I'm fine with that. Although the only books they ever tell me are like, you know, NSA, Stasi.
You've got those already.
I already have them all. What I wanted to find out at the Journal in some of my investigations was, well, how is this being used to provide different prices? Because that's what I think is ultimately what I would want to do if I was a retailer. And so we did find, in 2010, we found that Capital One was using this information to change the credit card it offered you as the first, when you just went to their website, they've never seen you before, and it was like, boom, here's the card for you, right? And it was kind of disturbing because we analyzed the traffic that your website sent back and forth to them, and it said in the traffic, it would say their instant analysis, like low income or middle income, and how much education they thought you had. Now, let's be fair, you can apply for any credit card you want, right? So your choice isn't being fully limited, it's only just being scoped, right, as to what we think you might want. But then in 2012, what we found was that we found Staples was actually changing its prices for everybody, and it wasn't optional, right? As soon as they identified your physical location, they made an instant assessment of how close you were to a competitor store. And if you were close enough, they would give you a better price because they thought maybe you might go to the competitor. And if you weren't that close, they would give you a higher price. And so that was, so you could buy a stapler, an actual stapler. We bought two staplers, the same exact one from two different locations for two different prices and had them shipped to the same location. And this is going to become more and more possible. And what I'm concerned about is, what does that mean? Because of course, it's perfectly competitive and legal to do discrimination by price, and economists sometimes argue that it's the perfect pricing. But it's also true that when we looked at the data for staples nationwide, the people who live near competitor stores are lower income and racial minorities, and they're getting the higher prices. They're living farther away from the stores, right, from the competitor store, so they're getting the higher prices. So I think we may need to rethink what is redlining, what do we want, what do we consider fair in our system? Because the ability to be unfair is going to increase technologically. And so I just raised the question of where do we want to draw the line as a society of like how willing we are for people to be charged different prices based on their individual attributes.
And you show so powerfully this is very literal classification. You were put in one category that Nielsen or someone thought that you were a high-tech spender or something.
Yep.
And then there are the others who are the blue-collar blues, many of whom are minorities, who are charged permanently different prices because of whom Nielsen thinks they are. Should that be illegal?
Right. Well, that is the question we need to confront. I don't think this society has ever had to answer that question. So we have very technical definitions of redlining, mostly having to do with credit and loan applications and racial minorities. And we need to think a little bigger about where else we want to draw those lines. Because the thing about our digital world is that although it seems like when you go onto the internet you can see anything in the whole world, it's also true that you can be trapped in sort of what I call a hall of mirrors, where all you see is what all of those websites think you are, right? And think you want to see and think the price that you should have.
Talk more about this hall of mirrors. You give so powerfully the example of people in the last election who visited Mitt Romney's website only getting Romney ads, and people who visited the Obama website visiting Obama ads. And Julia describes how literally you visit the Romney website and a cookie placed on your computer is auctioned off in real time to a company that earns the right to send you these Romney ads forever. And the result is that we're living in what Eli Pariser has called a filter bubble, where the ads you see and even the news you consume and the entire reality that you inhabit is defined by who the websites think they are. Talk about that filter bubble.
So in the last election, I found this incredible example of the filter bubble, which was that if you went to Google and typed in Obama and did a search for Obama, then your subsequent searches, whether they were for guns or abortion or just cats, would have guns or whatever at the top, and then three search results in the middle that were Obama plus whatever the topic was. So Obama's position on cats, right? Three search results and then more cats. And when you did the same for Romney, so you searched for Romney, and then your subsequent research results didn't have that, right? There were no Romney plus cats. And so I tested this across the country, and I came to Google with it about a week before the election. I said, what are you guys doing? You know, what's happening here? If we at the Wall Street Journal had said, we noticed that you read the Obama story on the front page, so now the story in Personal Journal about toothpaste is going to have Obama's views on toothpaste, we would literally be strung up, okay? So what's the deal? And they were like, oh, it's just the algorithm. The algorithm found that people who read Obama news want more Obama news, and the people who read Romney news don't want more Romney news. Now, that might actually be true, because Obama won, Romney didn't. But is it fair, right? And is it fair for Google to make that assumption for us?
Is it? Back to Brandeis, is it consistent with democratic values? Can you live in a society in which we only hear one side of the story?
Right, well, that's the challenge, right? That's why I really felt at the end of all my reporting that the key issue here was fairness, right? It doesn't make you feel like you live in a fair society if you're not seeing your news presented fairly, right? And so I think we need to figure out ways to make sure that we can keep all the fabulous technology, which I love. I love all of it. I want all of it. I want to be able to, you know, log on to my, you know, remotely from here and get my files from home. But I want to mitigate the unfairness that is right now completely legal and ubiquitous.
Another harm, more unfairness, virtual police lineups and Google Glass. What's going to happen there?
So I talk a little bit in my book about what I call virtual police lineups, which is essentially the idea that before all this surveillance was really ubiquitous, there was no reason that a normal person would have a file at their local police department or would be on file kind of anywhere. But now, for instance, local police departments have these license plate readers. And so they drive around and they scan all the license plates that they're driving by and keep them in a file forever in some cases. And that means that they have kind of a history of your location, where you've been parked for the past 3 years, or if you're driving, they also can take pictures of where you're driving on the street. They photograph the oncoming traffic and the traffic in front and behind. And so what we found was a guy in California who FOIA'd his, he filed a Freedom of Information Act request for his automatic license plate records. And his little town had photographed him, I think, more than 200 times, including his kids getting in and out of his car in the driveway. And that was on file in the police department, and they're going to keep it forever, right? And so this has changed the presumption of innocence in my mind, right? Which is no longer do you have to be a suspect to be surveilled. And I think that the challenge there is that then the police can go fishing in that data to just look, well, did they get out of the car in his, did the kids get out of the car in his driveway in a way that crossed, like, disobeyed some law about, you know, there's so many laws on the book that you don't know, right? It might be illegal to park your car one lot, like, wheel over the edge onto the sidewalk. Who knows, right? So now they have a way to find something on everybody.
Like the guy with the GPS device on the bottom of his car who was stopped because he turned without making a signal. So all of us, when we drive, violate traffic laws, and the Supreme Court has said, you don't, even if it's a pretext, the stop is okay, as if you violate some minor law, and you're saying with all of this data, we're all vulnerable to being
right. And I tell the story in my book of a guy who I think is a really compelling example of this. He he's a boiler repairman up in Massachusetts, in Western Mass, and he basically one day got a notice in the mail that his driver's license had been suspended, and he didn't know why. And they said, you have to come to a hearing. So he went there. And they said, we have this facial recognition program, and it found that your photo looked very similar to this other guy, so we think it's identity theft. So prove who you are, right? So he was basically chosen, presumed guilty and had to prove his innocence. Well, he was who he was, and their program flagged the wrong people, and they actually accused him. They said, you don't even look like your photo. And he was like, yes, that photo was taken 13 years ago, and I'm 100 pounds heavier now, right? And so, like, this is the debate he's having with the DMV. And so that's what happens in this world where the algorithms are sort of unchecked. And I want to build due process into that, right? He needed the right to be informed far earlier.
Digital due process is a very powerful theme of this book.
Yep.
In order to dramatize the difficulty of protecting privacy, spent a year doing a privacy audit on yourself, coming up with a threat model, and then enlisting every available technology to protect your own privacy. We've seen the Faraday bag. Let's talk about some of the other rigors that you endured for the sake of civic discourse. One of the most dramatic of which is you left Google and went to a website called DuckDuckGo. What was that like?
Yeah, so I quit using Google search because I saw how my searches were so revealing and I didn't want them stored. And even if you don't have Gmail, they're still storing them based on your IP address, which is a level of anonymity. But in my case, if you go to a website and look up my IP address, it basically locates me right in my home. So they can be very revealing. So I decided to switch to a search engine that's actually based here in Philadelphia called DuckDuckGo that is privacy protecting. They don't store any IP addresses and they don't store any searches. So every time I go to them, it's like a fresh new experience. They don't know who I am. So it actually took me a while to learn how to use it because I was used to the idea that Google would finish my sentences. You know, you start typing and then they already know what you want and they fill it in for you. But once I realized that it wasn't that hard to add the word New York at the end of a search just to make sure it wasn't like the Natural History Museum in London, which they love to give me, I really started to appreciate the fact that my searches weren't tailored because I felt I had the control myself over what I was looking for.
You have many useful tips about creating secure passwords. And I felt, oh my God, I'm never going to be able to remember them. I mean, like everyone else, I have the obvious one with an exclamation point or something put at the end of it. And now I realize
hack
I'm a complete
him.
Hack me. What do I know? I just write about privacy. What's the takeaway for how people can create secure passwords?
So passwords are a terrible situation right now. So I guess What I ended up doing was basically using a password manager, because there's software that will just generate passwords for you, because it's impossible for anyone to try to come up with all of these passwords themselves. And then I hired my daughter to use a special technique where she rolled dice and picked words out of a dictionary, and then she strung those words together so that I had 5 random dictionary words, and I used those for my super secure accounts, so for my email, bank, and for my password manager. If I was going to say one thing about passwords, if you're going to do one thing, anyone, please just change your email password to the longest possible thing and write it down. The myth that you can't write these things down, no, the likelihood someone's going to break into your house, get your wallet or the piece of paper, and then figure out that that's your Gmail password, very low.
I mean, you just pick a long word you remember, like supercalifragilisticexpialidocious. I mean, what do you
do? Well, the longer it is, the better, because the password hackers, their programs are designed to just try each letter of the password. So the longer the better, but if it's a well-known phrase like that, they're more likely to guess it. That's why I do random words from the dictionary, because those programs are not likely to guess those random words. And also I would just point out that we think we have a good ability to create random words, but our minds are not that random. So it is really better to try to come up with a way to find really random words.
And again, just for those who are not privacy paranoids, why is this important? What's the mud puddle test? And you know, why should people take the trouble to create?
Well, so passwords are actually really important. Even if you don't believe a single thing that I've been saying about privacy, you don't want to be hacked. And it's becoming incredibly common. And so it's just really important, particularly your email account can be used to reset all of your other passwords and to get into all your accounts. And so criminal hacking gangs are basically very expert at breaking passwords. So just that, even if you don't believe in privacy, change your password.
Would you have taken all these steps if you hadn't been writing the book? And will you continue to use these technologies?
You know what's interesting is I definitely started this as an exercise to see if I could do it and if I could educate myself and to investigate whether how hard it was to protect my privacy. But what I found is it's sort of like becoming a vegan. It's a way of life. It's like every day I have to wake up and choose not to use bad passwords and to choose to put my phone in a bag and to choose to not give my real name at the barista and, you know, everything. And so it has become a way of living. And it is kind of a pain, to be honest. But one, I really actually think that it's important for myself, for my kids. I've taught them all these techniques so that they won't wander into the digital world, sort of bearing everything and building a long trail that will always be with them. So I think it's worth doing, but some of it is impossible, right? The phone, basically, this is kind of, even I admit, this is not a good solution. In fact, the reason I do this is to show that maybe we need another way to block tracking other than technological means.
Should get to questions because they're so
a lot.
Excellent. There are a whole lot of them. So let's jump right in. Why is the average person so unconcerned about privacy rights? We all seem so willing to give up personal information.
Well, it's because we don't know the true cost of it. We're getting all these free services, and we love free. Everyone loves free, right? And what we're now waking up to 10, 20 years into the internet revolution is that they weren't really free. We were paying with our personal data. And now what we don't know is how much is that data worth? And it's a very uncertain time. We just don't have a way to quantify it. We can't tell how it will be used against us in the future. We can only speculate. And so I think it's perfectly rational to be confused about whether you should care, because this is an opaque market. It's like the bond market. You don't know what the prices are, and it's only the true experts who can really evaluate the price of their data.
Google claims it never shares a person's search history with anyone else. True?
Yes, Google says that. I mean, what's interesting about Google and Facebook is they have so much data themselves that they don't want to share it. They don't sell it. They keep it for themselves. They buy other data from the data brokers to enhance their profiles so that they have the best profiles out there. The problem with that is that the government is always at Google's door. I mean, we have seen that they come to them with these secret requests for data. We also saw that they had hacked into Google's data centers to get it when they couldn't get it through the front door. So by putting, I like Google, I would like to trust them with my data, but I don't know if they can defend themselves against the NSA.
Speaking of which, here's a great related question. If the Fourth Amendment requires a search warrant to search my home, why isn't a warrant required of the NSA to search any computer in my home?
Right, it's because of the third party doctrine. Basically, you put it on, I mean, if they go into your house and take your computer physically, they still need a warrant. But these days, it's so easy to remotely get the information from your computer that there's many ways to circumvent that search warrant requirement.
You talk in the book about this exciting case from California, the Cotterman case, where the Ninth Circuit just last year said computer searches, even if they're done at the border or outside the home, can potentially reveal so much about us that they have to be minimized, and the police should only be able to look for specified bits of information and not seize anything in plain view. Might that go anywhere? It's a very interesting
debate. Yeah, I mean, I think that was such a ray of hope, right? That was the first time that we'd seen any sort of limits, right? Right now, what happens is at the border, this happened to David House, a WikiLeaks volunteer. You know, they basically knew he was coming back to the country from an international trip. They took him aside, took his computer, copied the entire contents, and then let him go on because it's a perfect, they didn't have to get a warrant because there's an exception at the border. And so it's been a tool that they've used to find information from people who they want to track but don't want to get a warrant for. So that was a great moment that maybe there will be a standard, that legal standard required at the border, but so far that's only in one circuit.
You invoke the general warrants that sparked the American Revolution, the John Adams and the other framers like James Otis,
yep.
So concerned about these pieces of paper that allowed the king's agents to search anyone's house to search for seditious material or evidence of people not paying taxes, that they fought the revolution because of it. Is NSA surveillance like a general warrant, or because it's just metadata, that is the telephone numbers rather than the content, is it not like a general warrant?
I mean, I don't see how you could look at the collection of every single phone calling record for the past 7 years in the United States as anything other than a general warrant. I mean, it's the hugest database of connections and associations that possibly ever amassed, and that's what the NSA was doing with their 215 program. Now, they say that they didn't actually collect it. It's just sitting there, and they only collect it when they do a search in that data. And I think that's like a legal technicality that needs to be sorted out by the courts, and maybe they're right that it just doesn't exist. It's sort of like a tree falling in a forest if no one hears it. If it's sitting there and it's never touched, maybe we're okay with that. What I'm concerned about is what's the level of oversight to make sure that somebody isn't getting it? Because right now we're in a world where there's no data, it seems, that is safe. Edward Snowden himself walked out of the NSA with a lot of files he wasn't supposed to have. And so it's hard for me to trust their assurances that no one is looking at this other than these few searches.
And just to be consistent with the Constitution Center's nonpartisan mandate, the lower courts are split on this question. One judge, Judge Leon in Washington, says James Madison would have been appalled by the PRISM surveillance program. He would have been aghast about the slow incursions of liberty. Another judge in New York has reached the opposite conclusion and said because of the third-party doctrine, we don't have expectations of privacy in phone numbers we turn over to the phone company. Justice Scalia has said that he expects the Supreme Court to hear this at some point. Next question, if I try to hide my personal information from the NSA, won't that encourage them to do more surveillance about me?
Yes, it will. So,
good question.
It will. So we saw in some of the early Snowden documents that by using encryption, for instance, which is something I use as much as I can, putting my messages into secret codes that can't be read by the government, or hopefully will be really hard to read, I guess. We don't know yet whether they've broken it entirely. That it puts you on a suspicious list, and it allows them to store your data longer and keep it for analysis. And so I recognized early on in my project to protect my privacy that many of the things I was doing were likely to actually raise red flags. But I did it as a way of protest in some sense, because I basically felt that isn't fair. Just because I want to have a conversation that isn't read by someone else with my mother, I don't see that should put me on a list, and I sort of protest that assumption. So I went into this knowing that it might raise suspicions. I have not yet been detained at the border, but I expect it to happen anytime. And I think that we just have to think about whether that's the right standard, whether we want the NSA. They do work for us, after all. Like, is that what we want them to do? Maybe.
And the secondary pat-downs are a pain, but they haven't led to more trouble so far.
No, I do. Yeah, I do the pat-down every time. I don't do the body scanner because, you know, seriously, like, they have enough data about me. They don't need my naked body picture, too.
Just on that point, that was the one victory for privacy in this whole sorry tale. The government initially had these choices between the two scanners, the naked machine and the blob machine. One shows you naked. The other makes you a nondescript blob, which for most of us is an act of mercy at the airport. And they could have picked, both were equally effective. They could have picked the blob machine. In fact, they rolled out the naked machine. And it took that great political protest, the guy who a few years ago exclaimed at the border, "Don't touch my junk," the Patrick Henry of the body scanner movement.
Yep.
They went back to the drawing board, and President Obama was shocked to discover he could actually retrofit the naked machines as blob machines, and now at most of the big
now we're all blobbed.
We're all blobbed.
Right. I'm still not blobbing.
You won't even blob as a matter of principle.
I just don't blob as a matter of principle because there's so few opportunities to vote on this topic. I want there to be metrics.
Great.
So everyone says, oh, no one cares about privacy. You can see, you know, I was at Denver Airport, actually. I saw a sign, which is 95% of people opt into the body scanner. And I was like, aha, see, I'm the 5%. I want there to be numbers because they don't present it to you as an opt-in or as a choice, right? That's, you know, and so in some ways, a lot of what I'm doing here is sort of calling the bluff on the opt-in and opt-out situation. They're always like, oh, you choose. Well, okay, I'm choosing, right? Count me.
Who else would opt out of the body scanners? This is a very pro-privacy crowd.
Yeah.
Very, very impressive. Isn't Google a hypocrite for complaining about the NSA when Google is more invasive?
Well, Google's still not putting anyone in jail. So I think that Google has a right to be upset. I mean, when they found out that their data centers were being hacked into by the government, and after that, Microsoft came out with this incredible statement. They said, we now consider the government, the US government, to be our largest threat. Previously, it had been Chinese hackers. So they're like basically like, we're putting the NSA at the top of our hacking concerns. And so the tech companies are in a difficult position, which is they're in the US, they have to comply with the law, but I think they seem to be legitimately outraged that there was a lot of covert stuff going on. They were complying with these secret court orders on the front end, but they were unaware that the stuff was going on the back end, it seems.
Does the current Supreme Court understand enough about technology to make an effective privacy ruling? Justice Kagan has said that she's the most tech-savvy justice, and she remembers playing Pong as a kid. So.
I have to say, I went to hear the U.S. v. Jones oral arguments, and there was this great moment where Chief Justice Roberts said, wait, you mean they could track my car with a GPS tracker? And I was like, yay, right? So I think they're starting to wake up to this. I mean, how can you live in today's world and not be aware that this thing is transmitting information about you all the time?
They are reading briefs on iPads. They're understanding text messaging. I mean, how do you have to be really tech savvy, or basically the principles are broad enough that you can understand them without getting into the weeds?
I think that, no. I mean, look, the level of tech literacy in this country, I think, should increase. People are still a little bit too confused about sort of like the level of tracking that happens behind the scenes on websites. But there's been so much press about it that you'd have to be living under a rock, I think, not to know that. Which may be where the Supreme Court is located, but.
Well, but the Jones decision was 9-0. That surprised a lot of people, but not a single justice accepted the Obama administration's position that we have no expectation of privacy in public against ubiquitous surveillance.
Right, and I would also point out that there does seem to be an incredible movement across the country against drones. So many states, almost a dozen, I think, have passed laws limiting drone surveillance. So I think we are coming to the conclusion that when we're in public, just because you can fly an airplane or track a tracker to our car doesn't necessarily mean we've given up our privacy.
Is that to care about privacy, people have to be able to relate it to their own lives? Is that because we can imagine what it would be like to be followed by a drone
24/7? Yes, it's very visceral, I think.
Yeah, absolutely. These are completely great questions. Does the NSA and the government make an extra effort to get privacy information about reporters?
Well, I wish I knew that, right, since I'm a reporter. I think the evidence is unfortunately leans towards the answer being yes, because there was a Inspector General report a few years back about the FBI's use of national security letters targeting journalists and obtaining secretly information about their phone call records. We've seen that in the Jim Risen case, where this is a New York Times reporter who said that his phone records were obtained for a leak case. So I think we have to say that reporters are probably in a very difficult situation right now.
And 6 threatened prosecutions under the Espionage Act of 1917, more than all other administrations combined, including a question about whether or not publishers themselves could be charged.
Yeah, I mean, it's a, You know, if you don't care about privacy, that's fine. But I think it's also worth thinking about the challenge to journalists as an issue for our democracy, because journalists are supposed to be the watchdogs of democracy. And if we cannot have any contact with a source confidentially, because everything is surveilled, and we can only rely on sources who are willing to basically move to Russia and give up their entire lives, like Edward Snowden, we're not going to have as much of an ability to be a watchdog on our government. I think that's a question for our society to grapple with.
Have there been many or any legal cases where online browsing data has been used against defendants, not Facebook cases, or against job applicants?
I'm not sure if there have been explicitly. I mean, one of the problems with this information is that oftentimes if you're denied a job, you wouldn't know why. But it's pretty difficult for an employer, I would imagine, to get the online browsing data in most cases.
Based on First Amendment issues and surveillance concerns, why should we discuss this issue on Twitter with the Constitution Center?
That's great.
Excellent question.
You know, that's a good question. People ask me all the time why I'm on Twitter, because I quit Facebook and LinkedIn. Well, I didn't quite quit Facebook. I left a little page here. It was kind of snarky that says, I'm not here, I'm on Twitter. And I think that Twitter is a little more clear about its issues. It's public broadcast. It's like publishing in the newspaper to me. I put on there exactly what I would write for the consumption of the whole world. What I don't like about Facebook and LinkedIn is that your associations, your list of friends and contacts are basically public. And you know, we all think we're incredibly unique, but in fact, we basically like the same movies, music, and have the same political beliefs of many of our friends. And so our associations can be very revealing.
And Twitter and Facebook and Google all have different standards for free speech and what they'll remove. Twitter is the most speech protective and will only take down speech that threatens and is intended to provoke imminent lawless action. They basically adopted the US First Amendment standard.
Right.
Whereas Facebook and Google have community standards that allow more speech to be suppressed if it offends a religious group, for example, although not a religious leader. So maybe people should inform themselves about the different standards.
Yes, Twitter has been incredibly aggressive on defending its users' right to free speech.
On that point, we're living in a world where Google and Facebook have more power over who can speak and who can be heard and who is private than any king or president or Supreme Court justice, and yet the First and Fourth Amendments apply only to the government and not to Google. Do we need a constitutional amendment to protect free speech against Google and Facebook and privacy in a digital age?
Wow, I hadn't thought about that before, but that is an interesting question. I do think that we have to sort of evaluate when we go on to Facebook and Google, we think of ourselves sometimes as being in like the public square at a town hall, and in a way, we're really not. We're kind of in North Korea. We're like in a totalitarian dictatorship where whatever they decide is the rule for speech. And we have to think about whether we want, I mean, personally, my decision is let's not have the speech there. You know, I'm sort of opting out to a different way, but you could also force them to try to have free speech standards. And that there is a precedent for telecom companies having to abide by some standards for First Amendment. So that's a possibility.
We unfortunately have to end. I could continue this all afternoon. You end your book by talking about reforms. You're skeptical about the consent model because you think people might sell their privacy in exchange for a toaster, and once they sell it for a quarter of a cent, they might not be able to get it back. But you like the model, you like transparency, as Louis Brandeis did. And you like the Fair Credit Reporting Act, which tells people how much is being collected. And you have five questions that should be asked of every digital dragnet to decide whether or not it's fair or even legal. Shall I read them or do you want to
talk? Yes, you should read them because I might say
five questions is a lot to remember. Does the dragnet provide individuals with legal rights to access, correct, and dispute the data? Is the dragnet too intrusive for its purpose? Does it benefit society? Does it fall into the ugly abyss of racism or other prejudice? Can it withstand public scrutiny? These are wonderful questions that I think jurors at the time of the framing of the Fourth Amendment would have asked. Tell us more about these principles and how optimistic you are about them being adopted.
Well, I wish I was more optimistic, but I think that I feel like I'm sort of asking for not that much, but probably people would disagree. But I just feel that I wouldn't mind trading my data for services if I could have some assurances that if it was used against me, I would have some rights, that I could challenge the data, that I could see it, that I could sue over it, and that it was being used in the public benefit. It wasn't for to being used against me. And so I basically came up with these standards as a way, as my own thoughts about what would I want in order to trade my data and feel confident. Because I feel like we are in an information economy, and it's gonna be, although I've tried to opt out, it's not actually practical. What I would rather do is participate freely and have some assurances that I won't be harmed. This is how, cars are incredibly dangerous, but we get in them every day because we have some assurances that some safety measures have been taken and that we have redress if something goes wrong. And I want a similar standard for treatment of my data.
Wonderful. Ladies and gentlemen, and our C-SPAN audience as well, please come, first of all, downstairs and buy Julia's wonderful book on C-SPAN. Go to Amazon using an anonymized browser like Tor and buy the book. Come visit us at constitutioncenter.org, and please join me in thanking Julia Angwin.
Thank you.
Thank you. That was great.
Really great.